Hello dear students, welcome to the UGC lecture series on educational psychology. Today we would be discussing type and trait approach to personality. In my earlier lecture, I did talk on biological basis of personality, where we found how biologically personality is determined. When I am talking of types and a kind of an approach through types, it is connected with the biological approach. Now, understanding is that if a person's personality can be understood in terms of the physique he is possessing, the structure and the composition of his body, perhaps that could give us some idea about the temperament, about the behavior, or about the personality in general. The earliest work that has been conducted in this direction, earlier to Christ, you see, about 300 years, was Hippocrates' work, where what those people understood was just to take bodies of different people and find similarities in terms of bodies or body structures, and also find whether a particular trait structure or behavioral form or pattern can be connected with bodies. But one most clear work was done later on by Kreshma. It was in 1925, that is the date when his theory came, that temperament and physique can be connected. And he had three types of people to be identified through their physique or body. One was that picnic type, the other one was asthenic type, and the third one was athletic type. And with these three types, he joined three different temperaments: for picnic one, for asthenic one, and for the athletic one. But then this was a kind of path breaking in understanding of personality through types. But most formidable work, based on a lot of research conducted by William Sheldon. And William Sheldon, who did his work around 30s, was on body build, its constitution, and personality traits. What he did was about 4,000 college men. Their pictures were taken, that is completely bare body, or naked body pictures, and then responses toward different physiological or body compositions were made. On the basis of certain understandings and certain similarities here and there, he found that all these bodies can be placed in three different types. And this is first scientific approach, as people would call it, to understand personality in terms of physique or body. Now, he talks of three types, just starting with what we call endomorphs, mesomorphs, or ectomorphs. So, if the personality of the person can be either characterized by endomorphic characteristics, or mesomorphic characteristics, or ectomorphic characteristics. Now, if we take endomorphs, these are the people, if you look into the temperaments, into the kind of traits they possess, is that they would love pleasure, they would love eating, they would love food, they will be very social in nature, and given the body of a person, you can just predict what type of behavior he would exhibit or demonstrate in different situations. And then once you go to the mesomorph, the temperaments that you could connect with this kind of person is that he can be very hard, and he can be very aggressive, and maybe that he has his own way, and not necessarily connecting himself with society as such, but following his own ambitions, his own programs. And the third one, where we find that his basic feature would be that he is interested more or less in his own ways, is a person who is a solitary person, who loves isolation and would be least interested in others. But then whenever a kind of, you know, assignment and engagement, he would definitely try to face it. But you cannot very sharply say that he is the person who is completely, totally, grasped in society as such. No. These are three sharp personality features of these three systems, body systems. So where you have first you have those endomorphs, you have mesomorphs, and you have ectomorphs. And even now, people would say that earlier, if you could see hand of a person, you could tell him what type of personality you have. If you could see face of a person, you could see and you could tell him what type of a person you are. So it means that there must be some relationship between body type and the behavior type. That is what Sheldon was working out. When he talked about these three systems, are three compositions, are three dimensions of endomorphy, mesomorphy, and ectomorphy, actually he was talking about the body system. Like for instance, endomorph was the size of the digestive system within of the individual. It was broadly wider or heavier in weight. Naturally, the person would will be very much interested, inclined toward eating more and more and more, and would be very much interested in parties, would be very much interested in friends and social gatherings, etc., etc. And if you see the mesomorph, you will see it is actually body structure or the skeleton or his size, the size of the body structure as such. And therefore, naturally, what is directly can be connected with this kind of feature is perhaps the aggressiveness, is perhaps the hard work, is perhaps, perhaps the enthusiasm within the work. So you do not expect the kind of arrangement, the kind of friendships, etc., from mesomorph. And likewise, you have the ectomorph, and in ectomorph's activities, you'll find that mostly engrossed in his own self. And while he's engrossed in his own self, so he's, of course, he's having that very thin kind of sickness, he's sickeny type of person, And then you can look at the body of the person and see and predict what type of behavior he will be having at different moments of time. But now when we are talking about these body types, perhaps, yes, scientifically also, this body type understanding of personality has lost its charm. These days, we do not believe in the types of body because we do not know. If you have a mesomorph and you would always say that this mesomorph is a person who would be always engaged in hard works, would be very aggressive, you will find some people who are not having these kinds of features, in terms of behaviors, but then their body may be belonging to one set of understanding. So it is not possible, and it is also not advisable, that looking at the body of people, you just predict that what type of behavior this person can exhibit. Or, given the body of a person, you cannot fix the assignments with him. Thinking in your own way that if I have a mesomorph person, I can give him this kind of job, he would do. Why? Because he has this kind of body also. That has not proven successful where our researches were conducted. Then with types, we have another very important kind of theory in types that is given by Sigmund Freud. That is, he has divided the whole personality into three structures: id, ego, and superego. These are the structural compositions personality. So, id type personality, ego type personality, and superego type personality. If a person is highly inclined toward getting satisfactions, getting pleasures, getting enjoyments, you would say it is id in operation. The charge of this personality is in the hands of ego. So ego is the balancer. Whether you find a person consistently working in a balanced manner, you would say that ego is in charge of this person. A person who is highly condemning those things in the evil or instructing people, you will say that super ego is in charge. So you have ego-directed personality, you have id-directed personality, or you have super ego-directed personality. Now, this is also a kind of a typology that was presented by Dr. Freud. Then we have Professor Ising's, A.H. Ising's type theory, which is taken as three-dimensional treatment of personality. One, he found that, number of characteristic features of people can be put together, and after putting them together, you can label them as extroversion and others as introversion, and third one as neurotic. So there can be a personality which is extrovert in nature, which is definitely, decidedly for the society or other than the self. He is extrovert, he is interested in things which are happening around, that is, in the environment as such, whether the environment is immediate or it is distant, it is family or it is school or it is, society as a whole. But then on the other hand, you have introverts who are directly indulgent in their own selves, who rather would not think of the things around, but would mostly concentrate upon their own motives, upon their own intentions, upon their own attitudes, upon their own interests. And maybe at certain occasions, when there arises a conflict between external reality and internal kind of demand or need of such people, they would find ways in which this conflict can be resolved. And the third composition or the third dimension is that of neurotic personality. The neurotic personality is one in which you will find that the person who is tending to behave or who is actually behaving in such a manner, you will find that there is some kind of anxiety in his behavior. He is not able to, take himself to a particular point of satiation because you don't know, and that is not obviously known to us, that whether there is some kind of feeling of inferiority, feeling of whatever feeling, whatever nature of the feeling is there, which is pushing or pulling back the person who is holding charge of neurotic personality as such. So these were the three major types which are known to, there are a number of other theories also in the name of, types, but then these are most important types that have been presented by various theoreticians. One, as I talked about, Sheldon's body types. The other one, as did I talk about, the Freud's id, ego, superego. And the other one is Professor Ising's extroversion, introversion, and neuroticism. Now, while concluding this type theory, I would say that even if there is some merit in taking these types on one hand, and fixing different persons, their personalities in different, types, there is some advantage. You can have some idea about the world, but you cannot have the overall idea of a person, and his personality. You can't say on the basis of extroversion, introversion kind of typology that this person is extremely extrovert or extremely introvert, or he is neurotic. You cannot label that way, because there is a possibility of mixing up of these traits. You can have introversion, you can have extroversion, but both these things can mix themselves in you, so you can have a different type of personality altogether. Likewise, in Sheldon's scheme, mesomorph, ectomorph, endomorph, etc., they may even crisscross, they may even enter into the traits of one another, and you will not be actually giving a real or realistic idea about the personality of a person. Likewise, if you take id, ego, superego, you are not very clear that these are id impulses. All pleasures cannot be taken as id impulse. Maybe the expression of a feeling may seem to me it is pleasant expression, but may not be derived from the pleasure principle of id psychology. Therefore, whereas historically it is true that, of course, the assessment, understanding, having some idea of personality through types is quite fine, but at the same time we cannot completely 100% rely upon these theories for understanding, assessing, labeling or classifying personality. Now let us turn to another very important theory, which is really taken with well attention and care today, and this is trait approach to personality or trait theory. This trait theory is connected with Professor Gordon W. Allport. We have learned number of things about Allport even earlier, and I have even based my whole analysis lecture on personality on the basis of the definition given by Professor Allport. So Allport has a theory of personality, and this theory is generally known as trait theory of personality. Means that traits are representative of one's personality. These traits are basic defining properties or characteristics which, when taken into account, give you an idea of a personality. And therefore, traits can be scaled, they can be measured, you can assess numericals to them, so that you cannot render Allport's theory a subjective theory of personality. No. Once the traits have been measured through some mechanical operations, certain assessment techniques, then you can draw your conclusions about the person whose traits are known to us. Now, a trait with Allport is same as need with Murray. We did discuss about thematic apperception test, and we found there that those themes pictured on structured situations would actually give you an idea of the need to which a person is addressing himself. So what need does with Murray's conclusions in personality, trait does with Allport. What instinct does with Sigmund Freud, trait does with Allport. And what sentiment does with McDougall, trait does with Allport. So whether you are talking of sentiment, that is McDougall's terminology, you are talking of instinct, that is Freud's terminology, or you are talking of needs, that is Murray's terminology, or you are talking of traits, that is Allport's technology. What is trait? It is a characteristic which has the capacity to direct the person to action. It does not only direct, it guides a person. And in this way, you can have a comparison slightly between attitude, intention, and trait. You can have trait, you can have even personal dispositions, but there is a difference. That is, once you talk of personal dispositions, you are talking of attitudes, then the attitudes are toward a class of objects, or one object. It can be an attitude toward some country, attitude toward some person, attitude toward some system, that's attitude. But then trait, we can't say that trait can be connected with some objects, classes of objects, persons or things around. No. Therefore, even if attitude has a power of directing a person, attitude or even intention has a power of directing a person, so is personal disposition. But then trait which direct this person does not only direct, initiate, activate, motivate a person alone, but it also guides the person on a path how to act. So the transaction of normal human behavior through traits consistently over a period of time gives you an idea about the personality a person is having. Because these are the traits finally which give you a style of life, which give you consistency, and the consistency gives you an identity. Therefore, according to this trait theory, you get an identity, and identity is the thing that is a kind of introduction of a person. And when a person introduces himself through his traits, which are consistent with him over a period of time, you can say that this is the personality he is possessing. Now, these traits he has divided into three types. One, he talks of cardinal traits. The other one, secondary traits. And the third one is the central trait. So we have cardinal traits, secondary traits, and central traits. Now I'll talk about these in a small, simple detail. One, so far as the cardinal traits are concerned, these cardinal traits are just observable in the behavior of others. That is generally made use of in our association, in our social gatherings, in functions, at home, at workplace, wherever we are in schools, we are making use of these cardinal traits. Observable in all people's behavior, and we can scale them down as cardinal traits, because they express themselves frequently in the behavior of persons. Second one is the secondary trait, which secondary traits are infrequent. That is, their expression, their demonstration, or their use is restricted. Only occasionally such traits would be used by an individual. So secondary trait is not giving you an idea, a realistic idea about the personality of a person. But the third one, which is central trait, this central trait is one where the distinct features of the person, his style, his characteristics, his defining properties are exhibited through these traits. Alport believes that their number cannot exceed 10. There can be only, there are rather 10 such traits which you take as central traits. And these are such important traits that they give the consistency to a person. They give the style to a person. They actually confer a personality to the person. So because of these 10 traits, the person's personality would be demonstrated in a consistent manner. Therefore, knowledge of traits and really rather knowledge of central traits is most important for a personality psychologist. Even in our classes or classrooms as such, we'll find that our students in different classes, if you just look at people, you will have the type of people, the type of students, the type of teachers whom you think that there are some distinctive features which qualify uniquely those person's personality, which is not applicable to others. And while that you find that, yes, these are some features which are characteristic of one student are not characterizing features of another, you would say that central traits are in operation. So if you find that there is a person who is most compassionate, there is a student who is most compassionate, most tolerant, most accommodative, and you find that these are consistently trait patterns of this individual student, you would say that this consistency in these traits, you would say that these are ruling, governing, covering central traits of this student. He never goes beyond, or he never deviates from this trait structure. You would say that these are central traits. And if you find secondary, he may make use of, at times he may request people, have a requesting type of personality, but at times he will not be requesting, he would be commanding. So if he is commanding at one time, he is requesting at another time, he is negotiating at third time, and he is doing balancing at different time, you would say that these threats are balancing, are negotiating, are only secondary, are operation only occasionally. So they are secondary, they are not completely representative of the person's personality. The total representation comes through the traits which are central in nature. And therefore, if you would like to have the idea of the personality of a person, we would definitely go by central traits. But then, knowledge of the cardinal traits and secondary traits with respect to a person is also important. Why? Because they will complement or support. Mostly, the consistent patterns of a personality would definitely be connected with the supportive elements which I talk of cardinal or secondary. Means that it is not possible for a person, even while he is behaving at the secondary level of traits, he would leave out of his hand those traits which are defining properties for his personality. So all the three would definitely help us in understanding the personality of a person. That is what we call, in nutshell, is the trait theory of personality as proposed by Professor Gordon W. Allport. Thank you.